In the last video, I was telling you about the benefits of using in-memory databases rather than using mock repositories when you're doing unit testing. But as I said then, there are a few little pitfalls and problems that you might encounter along the way, and that's what I wanted to focus on this time. So let's take us back to where we were. We had this application where we'd got our models being an author who has a collection of books, and then a book who has an author, and we put together a DB context for that, our library context. And then in our test code, what we were doing was creating our in-memory database, associating that with the context, which we associated with the repository, and then all our tests run against that in-memory database and are completely isolated from the real database. In the example I've shown before, we were running this creation test, but that wasn't very realistic because it meant that all of the data we were using were being created in the actual program, in the controller. So what we really want to do is have our own mock data that we're going to create on the fly. So what I've done here is just put in a method called populate, which takes the context we want to populate and then creates one book and one author. So we've got Jane Eyre by Charlotte Bronte, and then puts it into the context, which when we use it here is going to be our in-memory database. So all we need to do is, after we've created the context, call populate, pass the context in, and now we'll have our appropriate data, and that will be created every time you run a test, so no worry about what's in any real database. Then we can get rid of that create for now, because what we want to have is something that's just going to test the index where that is stored. So our index in the controller, simply getting hold of all the books with the authors and returning that to the view to display. So in here, we're going to have to say something like var result equals underscore controller dot index. That is returning, as we saw, just an iAction result. So we need to cast that. So we'll change that to a view result. Then from that, we want to get the model, so that is going to be result.model, but in that case it's going to have to be as an enumerable of book, and then we can start doing some tests on that. So we could do something like assert dot r equal and then one and then model dot count, so we should only have one book in there. And then we might also have an assert dot r equal and then Jane Eyre and then model dot first dot title. And then maybe we should also have assert dot r equal Charlotte Bronte model dot first dot author dot name. And if we give that a quick run on the tests, we can see that that's all working fine as we'd expect. But there is a hidden bug in here already. Because if we just look at this index, we've actually done three asserts there. And it's not too bad in this case, but one of the principles of unit testing is we should really be testing for one thing at a time. So we might decide, for example, to have, as well as this index, we might actually want to split this up. So let's have an index and call that books. And in there, we will put the tests for book information, and then in here we'll call that index authors, and there we'll just test the author information. Borderline decision whether that's best practice to split them up, but it's certainly something you might see. And now if we run those, we suddenly see that index books is not working. And if we look at the problem, we can see that it's because on that test of the number of books, we expected one, obviously, and we've actually got two. You may be able to guess why that's happening. Just to show another aspect of this, though, what's really nasty about it, if I were to change the name of index authors to index writers and run the tests, then suddenly everything works fine, which is really nasty that simply renaming a test is going to turn a fail to a success. The reason the renaming changes what happens is because in this case, it's actually changing the order of the test because the Microsoft testing runs the tests in alphabetical order. And so previously, index authors ran first, but index writers runs second. Other test environments are a bit smarter, will typically randomize the order that they run the test. But if authors is running first, then we get the error because we've got two books rather than one. The problem's probably best explained by drawing a quick diagram. So what we've got here is our in-memory database. So let's have that represented by something looking a bit like a database. And then we've got our DB context. So that's our DB context, communicating with that database. And then each time we run one of the tests, we're running the setup. And so in the first case, we write a book and an author to the DB context. That's fine. But the second time, we add to the same database. And that means we end up with two books and two authors. And so we're getting the count to mismatch. What we need to do is simply make sure that we clean out the database before each one of those tests, and everything will be fine. In terms of the code, it's very simple. All we need to do here is just before we populate the context, just after we've created it, we say context.database.ensureDeleted. And what that does, as the name suggests, is just clears out the database so we've got a clean sheet before we then repopulate it. You can use ensure deleted on a real database as well. I'm not that common to do, but on a test database, it's a really good idea. So all we need to do is that, and that means when we run the tests, we get green lights because we've got a brand new database for each and every one, which is exactly what you want because you want each test to be entirely run in isolation, not in any way dependent on what's gone before in other tests. So that's one simple thing we can do to fix that particular problem. The other problem I wanted to show you is a slightly nasty one because the problem we had there, at least we had the situation where even though the code itself was working fine, notice I made no changes to my controller to fix that. That was an error in my test code. But the code was working fine, but the test still gave a red light, which is irritating, but not catastrophic. The next one I'm going to show you, though, is where the tests give a green light, even though the code doesn't work. And so what I'm going to do, I'm going to go back to my controller and introduce a bug. And the bug is going to be, I'm going to forget to do my eager loading. So what we're saying here at the moment correctly is saying load all the books and load up the authors of those books. But if I miss that off, then when we run that up, then we can see that we've got the title, we've got the year, but the author is a complete blank. Remember, this is the real database data, so the actual books and authors would be different anyway. But the problem is the author is a blank. And if we just look at the view to see how that's being displayed, we can see that in our index view, I actually put a bit of safety code in there that we've said author question mark dot name. And so that's why it gives a blank. If I hadn't put that in there, then we'd have actually got an exception raised because the author would have been null. And therefore, when we try to read the name, we get the exception, which in a sense is actually better because at least it would have raised the issue. Whereas here, it's quietly failing. So the code is not working. But if we run the tests on that code, we see the tests are still perfectly happy. And the reason that is because the eager loading doesn't really matter at all when it comes to an in-memory database. If we go back to the diagram that I had, we've got a slightly different problem going on now. The problem we've got now is that we create in memory our book, and our book has a reference to an author. And then we write all of that through the DB context to the database. Ultimately, when we do the save changes, it goes to the in-memory database. What we then do in the test is we try to read the data out of the DB context. And because we wrote the data through the DB context, then the DB context is still holding that data in memory. So it's still holding a book in memory with a reference to the author. And so when we fetch out the book, we don't need to do any eagle loading because the author is just already there attached. So the trick we need to do to make this work is, although we have to use the same database, we want to introduce a second DB context. So we use one DB context to do the population, and then a second DB context referring to the same database. But now, when we try and read in the data from that DB context, which we do during the tests, it has to go all the way to the database to get the data. And therefore, if we want the authors as well as the books, we've got to get the includes, we've got to get the eagle loading right. So that's the solution to this problem. Make sure you always initialize your data through a different DB context from the one that you use to read the data during the test. And so that's relatively simple. What we're going to have to do here is, in this case, we will change the name of that variable to our initialization context. So let's just call that init context. And then that's where we do the ensure deleted. And then also, that's the one that we do the populate on. Then we create a second DB context. So we'll call that the test context, the one we're actually going to run the tests on, and then put that in there. So that means that we're writing through one context, but we're reading through the other. And so the one we're reading through won't have had those entities already existent in memory, therefore bypassing the need to do an eagle load to get them in there. And so if we run that, we now see that the test fails, and the test fails in this case with a null reference exception, because where it tries to read the author's name, author is null because it's not been loaded in. Now, obviously, we don't want red lights, but we do want to get red lights in the test code when there is a fault in the actual application. And that's now what we're getting. Previously, it succeeded in the test, even though it failed in the program. And we know how to fix it because we just introduced the error for ourselves. So we just need to say dot include and then book gives book.author. And then if we run the tests, that will give us a green light. And if we run the program, we can see that we're now getting the author in there. So the important thing is there that the tests and the program are behaving the same way, which is what you want to achieve as much as possible with unit testing. So that was it. Just a couple of useful pointers when you're dealing with in-memory databases for unit testing. The first one, that make sure you do the ensure deleted as part of your setup so that each test is running in complete isolation with its own set of data. And the slightly more complicated one was the idea that we need to make sure that we write our mock data to the in-memory database through a different DB context from the one that we read in the tests so that it hasn't effectively pre-cached the data and therefore isn't taking into account our includes for the eagle loading. Both of those much, much better though than doing these things, as I showed you in the first video, with a mock repository containing lists of in-memory data. With those, I really just had to give up on the idea of unit testing for our eagle loading and just, do integration testing and make sure that those things were working. So I hope that was helpful. Any comments or questions, pop them in the comments section below, and also have a look at the sample code that you can get from GitHub through the link I've shown.